Good morning, everyone. Welcome back to Citizen by CNN. I'm Dana Bash and joined, as you can see, by my friends and colleagues, David Chalian, John King, and Abby Phillip. I feel like we're all exhaling after the week that was, and this week is still not over. I guess maybe we can say 2 weeks, right? Insurrection on the Capitol. A week later, an impeachment of the president. Is only the first time in history that's happened twice to the same president. And then, of course, all of the events of yesterday. The biggest, of course, was the 46th president being inaugurated and the history that was made with his vice president. So we have so many questions on all of that.
What do you have on tap for next Wednesday, Dana? What do you have on tap next
Wednesday? I'm waiting for my assignment, David. We can talk after this. So we have a lot of questions about all of this, and we're going to answer as many as we can this morning. You can also continue to submit your questions in the box at the top right of your screen. I want to start with this question, which just came in, and I'm pulling it up right now on my phone. Yesterday's immediate change in approach, demeanor, and tone was striking in so many ways. How does it feel to be returning to a newsroom that is hopefully less dominated by the toxicity of the outgoing president? I'm gonna start with Abby on this one.
It's a good question. I feel like we're still figuring it out. I mean, always when there's a start of a new administration, there's this period of time where you gotta figure out, okay, what's the news? How do you cover what's going on? Who are the players? Who knows what's really going on? Who doesn't? Who's in the loop? Who's not? I think we're in that phase right now, but it's so different. I mean, waking up this morning and really having no reason to care about what Donald Trump is tweeting or saying or thinking or doing is completely different from what we've been doing in the news business for the last 5 years plus. And I think it's going to feel a little bit less, I don't know. I mean, I wouldn't say less, interesting, because there's actually a lot going on. I mean, the Biden administration is extremely busy and they're working on a lot of things, and they are actually, I would say, fairly transparent in terms of being willing to communicate with the media about what is on their agenda, about what's on the president's schedule, press briefings every day, we're hearing now. But it's just less personality driven. And I think that that is different, but not bad. And it just might take a little bit of getting used to that we're no longer going to care about, you know, did the president wake up angry today, or did he wake up sad today? You know, I mean, we're caring more about kind of the business of the government, which is, I think, usually how things work around here.
Yeah, and to the people out there, there are a lot of people out there who say, you know, why do you guys read the president's tweets all the time in the previous administration? Well, we had no choice because that was how he communicated. He did not have a traditional government structure. He did not have a press office. You know, Dana, when we covered the White House, you could walk into the press secretary's office in the morning. Sometimes they had a gaggle. That's where you learned about the president's day. Often the president's own team in the Trump administration would learn about the president's thoughts from his Twitter feed. He did not have normal meetings. He did not have normal organizational structure. He did not set out to the departments, this is your business, you take this lead. So we're gonna go through a total reboot of the United States government. You saw that in Jen Psaki's briefing last night. She came in with the big binder. That's traditional. I remember, whether it was Mike McCurry in the Clinton administration or the team that in the George W. Bush administration, that's what the press secretary normally does, sits in his or her office for 4 or 5 hours, taking the incoming from all around the government, building up this book, and then you go in and read it out. So it's a much more traditional approach. But to Abby's point, everything is changing. Whatever your pick your issue, anybody out there listening and watching us right now, you care about the climate, 180. You care about healthcare and the COVID response, 180. Pick your issue, immigration, 180. Every compass policy point in the government is changing, and it's our job now to sort all this out. The reporting will be different because, as Abby notes, we're not just watching one person's opinion. We have to check the new cabinet as they get confirmed, the new sub-cabinet, all these agencies across government. It actually adds to the reporting challenge. We're going to have policy conversations in the United States of America, and you're already starting to see Republicans push back, not on tweets, not on personality, not on tone and tenor, but on substance. Great. Let's have it.
Yeah, absolutely. Back to the future is what I've been calling it. David, let me ask you another question from a viewer. And this question is, what all does Biden plan to do in his first 100 days? And how long may it take for his cabinet to be confirmed? That's an easy one.
Well, he woke up this morning with only one cabinet position filled and confirmed, his director of national intelligence, a first woman in that role, Avril Haines. And the Senate seems to think that they're going to be able to get some of his nominees through in short order here. I don't know when the cabinet will be fully complete. I know he is behind his predecessors, who woke up on their first full day in the White House with six or seven cabinet positions confirmed in the last few administrations. So, but that will come along. The Senate also has to still hammer out this whole power sharing agreement, how they're going to move forward on impeachment. Chuck Schumer and Mitch McConnell have their plates pretty full at the moment. But to the point about the first 100 days, they have made clear, the Biden team has made clear, right? This is all about COVID. It is why, even before he was president, he made that sort of primetime address to the country last Thursday night, I think it was, laying out his $1.9 trillion rescue plan. So that's going to be the first big legislative push on the Hill. A slew of the executive orders yesterday were about COVID. Today is all about COVID. And here's the reality. It's because that is going to define, in large part, this administration as a success or a failure. It is the immediate crisis that is inherited here. And right now, the burden is now on President Joe Biden and his team to get their arms around the spread of the virus, to get the vaccine distribution up and running at a much grander scale than it was, and to really bring this crisis to a close. If they are successful at doing that, or at least in the first 100 days showing progress that that's the course that they're on, they're going to get some runway, I think, for the rest of their agenda. They're going to get some ability and a hearing from the American people, Dana. But if they don't, if these first 100 days go by and they have no progress to show for it, and obviously, as good politicians that they are, they're trying to lower expectations as much as possible to buy themselves as much time right now. But let's be clear. If in the first 100 days they don't have real progress to point to, that the American people are experiencing that this battle against coronavirus has turned and is now on a better course, that's going to be a real problem for them in terms of having a hearing from the American people to get the rest of their agenda going. I think this is all about being able to wrap their arms around this virus.
You know, you use the word experiencing. That is such an important word, and it's a good way to think about it, right? Because you know, the next question I'm going to ask you about, Abby, I'll send it to you, about climate. You know, they could do great things on the climate, but we wouldn't experience it right away. With COVID, with the economy, we will experience it. We will know if it's better, particularly with COVID. But on the next question, Abby, this is about, actually, let's stick with COVID because this is important. This is another viewer question. COVID-19 treatment has been an incredible failure under the Trump administration. How will Biden-Harris get this back on track? So it's a continuation of what David was just talking about.
Yeah, I mean, this is obviously the biggest priority for them. And you see a couple of things happening simultaneously. And we'll see actually some more executive orders on this today. But one that really stands out to me is using the Defense Production Act to spur the production of PPE, of testing. Look, these are things that it's crazy that we're sitting here in January 2021 and still talking about. This is a conversation we were having about a year ago, and you know, 10 months ago, and it's still happening. And clearly, the Biden administration feels like there's room for them to do more. And then there's the vaccine rollout. The Biden administration also saying this morning that they didn't get anything, no plans, no blueprint for how this was going to go, and that they have to kind of build this ship from scratch. So, I think, pardon, that's my dog. That's Booker.
Is that Booker T?
The mail man. I think that the plan seems to be to ramp up testing, ramp up you know, ramp up the vaccine distribution simultaneously, but also ramp up the distribution and use of PPE. I mean, last night watching the inauguration festivities, it was so striking to see the Bidens always wearing a mask. Always. They were in, when they were in the White House, they were standing on the balcony. It's just the two of them. They're wearing a mask. And it's not an accident. It's a clear signal that they're sending to the American people that this is the new reality. There was the executive order yesterday mandating masks in federal buildings. That sounds like a small thing, but it actually, I think, will have pretty widespread impact in all 50 states where you have federal properties and federal assets where, you know, I know people who work in federal buildings in places like Tennessee and Kentucky, where mask wearing is not very commonplace. And so it's gonna have, I think, a pretty immediate impact. And all of those things we'll see, but over, you know, I think what most people agree is that it's not gonna be like flipping a switch and then tomorrow everything is better. Obviously, mm-hmm. the long tail of this virus is between 2 and 3 weeks in terms of when you even start to see the impact of some kind of intervention. So it's gonna be a while, but they're trying kind of everything. And it seems to me also, surging testing, their plan to surge testing to places like schools and businesses is also a key part of the plan, which kind of addresses one of the big sticking points of the last year, which was, how do we get schools open safely? How do we keep businesses open safely while also keeping, you know, patrons and workers safe?
Yeah, the school issue is something that is still remarkable that we're in January, almost a year later, and it hasn't been figured out. I want to dig deeper on this. John, this is for you. This viewer asks, evidence-based research on the pandemic has highlighted the inequalities directly affecting communities of color. Those same communities showed up overwhelmingly for the Biden-Harris ticket with the mandate, vote like your life depends on it. What can communities of color honestly expect in the form of long-lasting support? What a great question.
It is a great question. And you saw some evidence that yesterday, and again, the proof is in the delivery, right? Everything, the tone is different right out of the box. Change, change, change. To Abby's point about the COVID plan, and I'll get to the specifics of the question in a minute, Dr. Anthony Fauci was on a conference with the World Health Organization today. The Biden administration says, Dr. Fauci, speak, please, be out there speaking. Tell the hard truths. Don't hide things. Don't gloss things over. Talk about science and re-engage with the world. On the first full day, a dramatic change right there. If you watched President Biden yesterday, when he signed the executive orders, and then when he delivered the oath to his team, he kept using the term systemic racism, dealing with the inequities, and reaching out to these communities. So he is talking about these issues in a way President Trump never did. We know he understands why he is president of the United States and the communities that made him president of the United States. That's a political debt he owes. But you also see right out of the box the policy realization that I've been, you know, every day and on my daytime show, I go through these statistics, and just the disparities are stunning and sad and horrible, and a sad legacy for the United States dating back, you know, 5, 6, 8, 10 presidents, keep going back, because of the lack of healthcare in these communities, because of the lack of respect for these communities, because of they're always the last, right? When you're surging in resources, they're always your Flint, Michigans, your Detroits, always get the short end of the stick. So now you have a president who says right out of the box, no, actually, you're gonna be at the top of my list. You're gonna be very high on my list. I'm going to do this. The proof is in the delivery, right? And so people in those communities should know they have a president who's talking about them from day one. They have a president-elect who talked about them in the campaign and talked about them in the transition. So now let's watch, to Abby's point, are they going to surge testing? When do inner city public school teachers get vaccines? Because that's how you get those kids back to school, because they feel safer. When do you surge more testing into those communities? They tried to do this, and there are some great examples out there in cities and even small towns which have health disparities because of their rural distance from other things. How do you surge more testing into essential workers? This will be the challenge over the 100 days, but this is an issue the past president, the former president of the United States, hardly ever talked about. Hardly ever talked about. That Biden has come out of the box talking about it shows you they get it. Now the challenge is, you know, to deliver, but they've brought in people. He signed a specific executive order about this. So they have it on their radar from day one, which in and of itself is a big difference.
Let's go to another issue, and that is another huge campaign promise, and it was such a driving issue. I don't need to tell you this, David, for Democratic primary voters and general election voters, and that is about the climate crisis. With Biden's focus so heavily directed at the pandemic and climate, what steps can he realistically do to combat the intense polarization we are facing as a country?
On that issue specifically, the polarization on that issue, you mean?
Well, it sounds like they're saying polarization. I hope I'm not overstepping trying to make sure I get the question right. But it sounds like he is so focused on the climate, which unfortunately is has become a partisan issue. So how do you deal with that? That's an example of trying to work across party lines in partisan times on an issue that is very important. And he promised he would work very hard to address.
We're all old enough to remember, of course, where climate was actually seen as one of the issues that got a lot of bipartisan support. I remember, you know, John McCain and Joe Lieberman working together and Lindsey Graham. I mean, it was one of those issues that not that long ago was a place where our politics was sort of going to meet in the middle, and then it just completely over the last decade plus disintegrated back into sort of our polarized world of politics and made it very difficult to get progress on this issue. I mean, John mentioned before, and this is going to be so refreshing for those of us that actually cover politics and policy in the intersection of the two, is that we are now going to, in this era, get back to real policy disagreements between the parties and different visions in a whole range of policy areas. And out of the gate, one of the executive orders that I think has gotten the most sort of Republican pushback from Biden's first day is the Keystone XL pipeline issue. And, you know, the Republicans are out there saying Joe Biden just, you know, killed some jobs. There are some unions in favor of that Keystone XL pipeline construction who are displeased with this. And they claim, their argument is, he's caving to environmentalists on this. He also obviously, one of our close allies to the north there in Canada, starts off with a disagreement now with the Prime Minister of Canada on this issue as well. But here's one issue where Joe Biden is trying, as you said, to take that energy from inside the Democratic Party that climate is everything. It touches every piece and every corner of his policy agenda. He labels it as one of the four crises, right, or five crises that we are facing right now. And you see out of the gate, with Keystone, he is already putting a marker down that the way in which these debates were handled before or not, this is actually going to be a priority issue, and he's going to come down on the side of climate environmental activists. We saw the power of the Sunrise Movement and youth engagement on this issue throughout the Democratic nomination process. It is not going to be the Green New Deal, right? Joe Biden made that clear. Like he did not subscribe and just say, here's a massive legislative package. But what I do think the Biden administration is making clear is that climate is going to be a piece of everything they do. So when you see them talk about healthcare, when you see them talk about COVID, when you see them talk, they are going to weave in a climate policy agenda into each piece of the domestic agenda broadly. And I think that is going to be, that's a sort of a different take than we have seen from administrations in the past.
Yeah, that's so true. And speaking of administrations of the past, another question is, there have been several changes in the US, such as our economic and sociological development since the last administration. Or in the last administration, meaning the Trump administration. Will President Biden's policies be a return to the Obama era? Will there be new ideas that fit the needs of today? I'm going to make that a jump ball. Whoever wants it, take it.
Well, I feel like, my sense is, although it's a little bit, it's a little bit early, I think, to know how this is going to work, but I actually get the sense that the Biden agenda already is perhaps a little bit more ambitious even than the Obama agenda was, especially at the onset of the Obama era, because for a lot of reasons, but one of them is actually because when Obama came into office in 2008, I mean, the overarching issue was the economy, and it kind of almost forestalled everything else. They were able to get healthcare through, but it was a very, very tough, very, very long fight. And once that happened, much else, you know, there was not much room for big legislation after that. But you already see the Biden administration putting forward not just legislative ideas, but a whole sort of suite of government activity on a number of issues. And I think, like, if you take a look at, for example, immigration, you know, it's a pretty bold plan, and it's not clear to me how it's gonna get done in a very evenly divided Congress. But some of it involves being really aggressive with executive actions. I mean, yesterday they announced a deferral, basically a deferral of deportations for 100 days for, you know, low priority deportations. They are trying to kind of buck up the DACA program for Dreamers. They're going to be doing a lot of things at the agencies to create a different kind of immigration system than we've seen over the last 4 years. But then they also want, on the congressional side, a pathway to citizenship for people who are undocumented. I mean, they're putting they're putting together these pretty ambitious plans that have failed in the past, frankly, in Congress. And there's a difference between what are their ambitions and what can they actually get done. I really think that, but I do think that just given that Biden is not a sort of pie in the sky type of person, it has been interesting for me to see that some of these plans coming out of the transition, some of these ideas that you're hearing are actually pretty aggressive in certain ways, maybe not as aggressive as some progressives might want. And they might have some trouble in a deeply divided Congress. Even this $1.9 trillion COVID bill, again, that's a big price tag. And they know it's going to be tough, but they're still putting that out there at the beginning. And I think that that says a lot. And it's different from the Obama era, where they kind of felt like they only had like one or two big bites at the apple. And then after that, they kind of just tried to nibble around the edges. And that was deeply frustrating to many Democrats and progressives. But you know, I think that was their view of the politics at the time. And I think Biden clearly, maybe this is his sense of confidence that he can work across the aisle. He seems to believe that there's more room for the executive branch to do things and for Congress to do more than they've been willing to do in 12 years, frankly.
Yeah, no, I think all of these issues
are such a key test of the post-Trump Republican Party. And you talk about socioeconomic impact. Who gets screwed? Where are the big power plants? Where are the big oil refineries? They're in communities of color, communities of, you know, poor people. Right? They always get the short end of the stick. David mentioned climate change. What a big difference, right? We're not having an argument anymore about does climate change exist? Of course climate change exists. But when you have a president who says it's a hoax, you're arguing about does it exist? Well, that's a waste of time. The argument should be about what to do about it. Right. And then you can have a debate. How much is federal government? How much is free market? How much is business? Great. Let's have those debates. But the test now is, you know, Trump is gone. Right. Corporate America, the Chamber of Commerce, the big oil companies, they want a conversation about climate now. Corporate America wants a conversation about a path to citizenship. These debates we've been stuck in for 25 years with no progress. There's a lot of factions that are aligned with Republicans that say, can we have some adult conversations? Can we just get this stuff out of the way? How can we deal with the big issues of tomorrow when we're still debating the issues of yesterday and last decade? And so can Republican leadership, can Joe Biden find enough of them? To Abby's point, he's not going to get all of them. Can he find enough of them on this issue to advance the ball? On that issue to advance the ball? And then can he turn to progressives and say, we're not getting the whole pie here. I don't have the votes for the whole pie here. But we're going to take half the pie. We're going to take 3/4 of the pie, and then we'll come back next year for more. Will he do that? That's why I think this change has opened so many fascinating questions.
And I'll just add that I think, Abby, you picked the perfect issue to illustrate this when you talked about immigration, because I think it also shows where the Democratic Party has moved. Even though Joe Biden was not at the front of the charge leading the way to move the party to the left, obviously he was the one in the nomination fight that was seen a little more centrist, but with the best chance to defeat Donald Trump and what have you. But he always was saying throughout that campaign that, you know, he was proposing, which is true, as progressive an agenda has ever as existed in the United States in recent times. And I just think about if Barack Obama on his first day in office in 2009 had sent up a legislative proposal for a pathway to citizenship for 11 million undocumented immigrants in this country, I think like heads would have exploded. And yet that is what Joe Biden did, because there has been a shift, certainly within the Democratic Party. And as John says, even with some coalitions about on the Republican side that want to see some action on this, but there's been a shift in the way in which Democrats expect Joe Biden to fight for their agenda, as you said, though, Abby, even if we don't know that that's where it's going to land, that they want, they sort of, I think, are winning the battle and getting him to start these fights by putting these agenda items in a really assertive manner at the outset, to then come in, as John is saying, from behind and say, now we have to compromise. You know, so it's just a really interesting moment, I think, to see on that issue. It's unthinkable a Democrat could have done that.
I'm always going to remember that Chalianism, winning the bet. They're winning the battle by getting him to start the fight. That was awesome. Even for you, you have to even your best. Okay. Let's move to another question from a viewer, which is, following the events in the Capitol over the last few weeks, how do you think President Biden will deal with the domestic terrorists and far-right Republican supporters who still relentlessly believe that Biden has not rightfully earned his place in the White House? I think he's going to try to ignore them. I don't know what you guys think. Abby?
I think what's going to, in Washington, it feels like, I don't think Biden's going to be spending a whole lot of his time doing battle with the Josh Hawleys of the world and the Ted Cruzes over this particular issue. I don't think that he has any interest in doing that whatsoever. But where you can look, where I would look for action is at DOJ and at Homeland Security. Because beyond the politics of this, this is a real national security, homeland security issue for this country going forward. And I do think that that is very clear to people in that space right now, that the ball has been dropped in terms of understanding the ties between, you know, these extremist individuals and groups and ideologies, and how to combat them before they become truly dangerous. And I think you're going to see the sort of Biden response to this playing out in how the government actually tries to really catch up on what's going on in the country and combating that kind of homegrown extremism that showed its face 2 weeks ago. So, you know, I don't think Biden really wants to look. His speech yesterday, his inauguration speech yesterday, was clearly a call to Republicans to come back into the mainstream, to abandon some of the fringy elements that are starting to infiltrate, especially in the House, you know, with the QAnon caucus and the, you know, 140 lawmakers who voted to reject the Electoral College. He is trying to say to them, there's an opportunity here to get back to policy, to get back to governance, to get back to think to our real differences. And that is, I think, is probably where he wants to be. But do I think he wants to continue to have this issue dominate his presidency? Absolutely not. I don't think we're going to see Joe Biden referring back to, you know, these doubts that Republicans sowed about his own election. I think he's ready to move on. But will we see DOJ and the FBI and DHS really taking a strong stance against, white supremacist and conspiracy theorist motivated violence? Absolutely. I think that's going to be part of the mandate that they have going forward.
Let's talk about the new vice president. This question is, how impactful do you believe Kamala Harris will be in the office with POTUS Biden? Do you believe she will be instrumental in policymaking as she was as an AG, or less likely to fall back and acquiesce to Biden? She is the VP. She's not the AG, but David or John?
I think it's TBD in some ways, because she's going to be so important in the United States Senate in the short term. Her constitutional duty as president of the Senate, because of the 50-50 tie, she may find herself in the middle of these Washington debates more than she would like, and more than the new president would like, actually. You can see, A, as someone who served 8 years as vice president, he wants to empower that position. B, I think he sees the great asset he now has in this history-making vice president, not just around the country, but around the world. What a projection of the new America, the changed America. Donald Trump is gone, and we have a very different team to send the vice president around the world, right? Not an area where she has a ton of expertise. So also for her own political future, something she very much would like to do. Be an American ambassador. Go around the world on these big issues, whether it's climate, whether it's reengaging on the pandemic, reengaging alliances, a chance for her to build the foreign policy international resume that she doesn't have as much of as she looks forward to her future. And Joe Biden's going to be pretty busy. Now, he loves that stuff. There'll be a little creative tension. I don't mean that in a bad way at all, because that's what he wants to do. He's the Senate foreign relations guy. He wants to get out and see the world. He's finally president after all these tries. But I do think this is a fascinating question for the new administration, because she is history for all Americans and for anybody watching around the world. But she's a great asset to Joe Biden. But I do think, you know, tactically at the moment, they have to assume, especially in this first 100 days, you're trying to get stuff done in Washington, that she's going to be up there where she was yesterday with that gavel. Just one more quick point. You know, her laughter was contagious yesterday. We've had this horrible year of the pandemic. We've had the toxicity of Trump, especially 2 months of lying about an election. Just to see people laughing. She made Mitch McConnell joke, you know, and that's good. That's not going to solve COVID. It's not going to get anybody a job. But just the circuit breaker of laughter after so much tension, I just found it so refreshing. She is obviously, you know, giddy at the challenge and the opportunity, and that's good.
Yeah, that is good. David, this is not funny. Sorry to be Debbie Downer.
Hard turn. Yeah, that's okay. Debbie Downer,
very hard turn. This viewer asks, do you think the impeachment of the president by Democrats will hurt the relationship between the Republicans in Congress and Joe Biden?
Well, actually, Joe Biden and the Republicans in the Senate may be more on the same page here with impeachment, of trying to get it done and behind them as quickly as possible, than Joe Biden and some of the Democrats in the Senate. Listen, this is a, you were just describing at the top when we started here, Dana. I mean, this is now the third Wednesday in a row of just in these last three Wednesdays to go from insurrection to impeachment to inauguration. It's been a breakneck sort of pace of these events that will live on in history for quite some time. And there was a rush before Donald Trump left town that House Democrats felt he had to be held accountable for inciting that riotous crowd, that mob that went up to the Capitol and launched that attack, that insurrection. You know, with each passing day, it's not that accountability isn't needed anymore, but you now have this turn of the page and a new administration, and the Biden folks don't want to be bogged down in weeks-long impeachment trial that is all Donald Trump focused and looking back at January 6th instead of moving ahead with his agenda. And so, and yet they understand there is this a constitutional role that the Senate now has to play. It looks like the House Speaker is going to send over the articles of impeachment tomorrow, perhaps, according to our reporting. And there's some reporting out there this morning, I think, that said there is a consensus forming, it seems, to have a really speedy trial on this matter. Now, the president, I don't think, has identified his legal team yet. I think there are things to work out there about exactly how the trial will take place. But I don't think it's, I don't think anybody right now sees it in their political interest, nor more importantly, in the interest of the country, to be mired for weeks in a Senate impeachment trial for a president who is already no longer president. And yet there is an accountability measure here that will take place and a constitutional role that the Senate will fulfill. You heard what Jen Psaki said last night. You've heard Joe Biden talk about this. Congress is going to work its act. They are not going to sort of join forces with them and make this part of the Biden administration's initial mission here to get impeachment done and wrap it up. They want Congress to move through it, and they want Congress to move through it quickly. And by the way, I think that aligns actually with what Mitch McConnell would like to do as well, not be lost in some whip count of whether or not there are 17 Republicans who are going to convict or deal with the backlash from his own conference if he actually remains open to conviction. I think there are a lot of interests aligned here to move pretty quickly through this.
Okay, so we have two two questions on impeachment coming from different points of view. Let's start with this one. At a time when Donald Trump's approval rating is at 23%, 28 million people are without health insurance, 40 million people are facing the possibility of becoming homeless. Why should the American people care about impeachment? Abby?
That's a great question. I think it's a very legitimate question. I think the argument that Democrats are making about impeachment is that it's an important deterrent. It's an important marker, both historically and also for the future, that anything like this, you know, if anything like this happens again, that there are consequences. And also that it ought to deter future leaders or even President Trump himself, who is at the moment not disqualified from holding federal office again, but could potentially run again, from trying to do the same thing twice. You know, impeachment itself isn't going to prevent Trump from running for office again, but they could vote subsequently to do just that. And that would really send a very strong signal. So that's the argument. I mean, on the other hand, the issue is timing. You know, if you're Joe Biden right now, you probably agree with that questioner who says, Joe Biden's thinking, I've got a lot of stuff to do for the American people. You know, the crises that are facing the country are pretty significant. And I'm sure he is also sympathetic to the idea that this sort of behavior needs to be deterred. But, you know, in a perfect world, would they be happening simultaneously? Absolutely not. But, you know, I would say this, you know, I think the way that the people in Congress who believe that impeachment is necessary, even if it might delay other priorities, the argument is basically this, that, you know, what happened 2 weeks ago was an incredibly close call for this country and for democracy. And we came on a razor's edge of losing our democratic system, which undergirds everything, including, you know, all other policy, whether it is, you know, it's stimulus checks or, you know, federal aid for testing. None of that is possible if we don't have a functioning government. And so in order to prevent the government from collapsing under the weight of people who are seeking to undermine the democratic process, you have to address that first. That's the argument. And that is cold comfort, though, obviously, for people who are trying to pay their rent and pay their heat bills and figure out how to put food on the table. And it's a shame that, you know, here's the reality. Congress can do both if they wanted to, but yeah, and they may not. They probably will not because of politics. That's the reality of the situation.
And I'll just add one other dynamic there for those who have been arguing to do this. It's not just history. It's not just a deterrent. It's justice. It's that they, you know, fundamentally believe that the president needs to be held accountable, just like anybody else who commits a crime should be held accountable for justice. And that, I'll just get to that side of the equation from this other viewer who says, I believe it's important for posterity. When the abhorrent Trump, when Trump is studied 100 years from now and details, historic details and events leading to the attempted coup by militia ascending upon the US Capitol, not only should the record show that the domestic terrorists were punished, but that Trump's outcry for insurrection was met with a swift impeachment and conviction of his crimes.
I think so. There's the issue on the table, and the questions are related to this one. That's somebody who believes there should be accountability, that just because he's gone, just because something else has come up that you have to deal with, doesn't mean that you just completely forget and give a pass to somebody. Now, you know, could the Republicans still come forward? Censure does no good right now because he's a former president, right? Or can you argue that puts some stain at least on the record? If the question is, can he run for, can you bar him from running again? You know, you could have a 14th Amendment conversation, you know, bring in constitutional lawyers for next week's conversation, you know, to have a debate about the legality of all that. But this is what, again, so will the impeachment trial just, you know, will that in itself bring a possible conversation and debate about are there other options? I think we're going to go down that path. To David's point, the Biden team and the McConnell team probably agree, let's do it as quickly as possible. But you take both questions, the fervor for accountability, which is quite understandable, especially because the president of the United States told his people, march on the Capitol, don't be weak. And then to the point Abby was making, the first question just shows me how expectations for this town have been so lowered. And that's part of the political disaffection in both parties, among Democrats, among Republicans, among independents. There's 535 of them, right? Think of somebody out there right now who's got to get the kids to school, get the grocery shopping, go to their own job. Maybe they got a plumbing problem or an HVAC problem at their house. When do I get a COVID vaccine? You know, how do I get ready to do my tax seasons? You know, working American class Americans are dealing with 100 problems at once, 100 issues at once, 100 challenges at once. And in the Congress, we think, well, we can only do one thing at a time. That's why nobody, you know, this town drives people crazy. And that's part of the question. You have 535 of them, Joe Biden building a giant government team. They better be able to do more than one thing at a time. Because as he said yesterday, whether you agree with the new president or not, I think he was pretty smart in laying out yesterday this collision of crises that he has no choice but to deal with right out of the box.
No, that's very true. Okay, one last question, and then we have a lightning round. And this is for you, David, President Biden is certainly a talented, likable, and politically strong individual. Does he have strength, power, and backing to get our country back online and substantially rid the nation of Trumpism?
You know, what I thought was so skillful in the way Joe Biden handled his inaugural address is that he took that question and said, that's not a question for me. That's actually a question for the country. And he challenged Americans to join forces together, and not unity for unity's sake, but actually that is the only way that we are going to deliver ourselves from a dark moment that the country is currently in, facing the crises that John just mentioned, to a better place. And that only happens if people come together to do that. Now he said, and he understands, that doesn't mean everybody, right? He said, enough of us. Enough of us need to come together in some fashion to deliver us to a better place in our politics and a better course for the future of the country than we're currently facing with these crises. And I just thought that notion of, it wasn't how Joe Biden was going to deliver that or his doctrine or his vision. He had from that. It was this challenge to America and to Americans to step up and join in this process of delivering us to a better place than we're in today.
It's so true. Okay. I'm just going to actually ask the same question in this lightning round. I know this is probably a hard question to answer quickly, but let's just try going down, starting with Abby. What's it like covering events like this?
Exhausting, right, Dana? It is a stamina exercise here, getting through a full inauguration day from sunup to, you know, basically midnight. And
way before sunup, Abby.
Right, way before sunup. But it's really, really fun. I mean, the moment for me was like just looking out as the sun was coming up and we were sitting on the set and looking out at the White House and the Washington Monument and thinking to myself, this is amazing that I get to sit here on this incredible day and watch the sun rise on a really historic day for this country. And I'm literally staring at the White House. It's so cool. And we have the best job in the world sometimes, even if it means that we don't get any sleep.
Yeah, I would just say it's a privilege. We get to be the eyes and the ears of the people watching this conversation and watching around the world at great events. That was my 9th inaugural yesterday. 5 of them have involved one party handing party over to another party. And I said it just to Wolf yesterday. I said, it's cool. It just is. I'm sorry. I'm a kid about these things sometimes and I get corny, but it's cool and it's a privilege.
Yeah, it's a dream is the word I would use. It's a total dream. I was on New Day this morning and I shared this story that, you know, as a first grade kid who weathered the P page in the Encyclopedia Britannica to look at all the presidents' portraits and names and memorize every president's name in reverse chronological order and recite it to anybody I could possibly do, to then get to actually cover these events like yesterday, it's a total dream.
Don't you guys wish you had a time machine and you could go back and spend time with David Chalian at that age?
I know.
So cute. I'll take it. If he's on the P page, I'll take the ABC Britannica and go read something else.
All right. Well, I am, and for those of you at home who don't know what the Encyclopedia Britannica is, you can Google it. I'll get from there. We also, before we go, we want to give a birthday shout out to somebody who has been an avid watcher, and we really appreciate it. Your name, as you see there, is Brittany Polly, who says she has not missed a single one of these events. Happy 31st birthday, Brittany. Abby, I'm going to put you on the spot. You want to sing to her?
Okay, I'll do it just because Brittany has been watching. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Brittany. Wow. Happy birthday to you.
Dana, did you know Abby had such a fantastic voice?
Inside Politics Sunday with Abby Phillip, the new show has a singing segment.
Oh my goodness, that's amazing.
Isn't that great?
Happy birthday, Brittany. Right. That was pretty cool.
Happy birthday, Brittany. Thank you, everybody, for watching this morning. We really have loved doing this. I mean, who else would not want to sit around talking to your friends about things that you're really interested in and get to listen to Abby Phillip sing you happy birthday? That's pretty cool. And we're going to continue through President Biden's first 100 days. So mark your calendar for the next citizen event. It is Tuesday, February 2nd at 10 a.m. Have a great day. Thanks, everybody.